I just want to remind counsel that you need to unmute if you want us to hear your argument. We cannot hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, thank you. And everybody else should mute in the meantime. Thank you very much. You may proceed.
May I proceed?
Yes, please.
Okay. May it please the court. My name is Herbert Fogel, and I represent LawFund Matter. The case is so well briefed that it's not necessary really to repeat all the issues and respond. However, one point should be emphasized because it is so obvious that the district court got it wrong. The lower court predicated its decision in part on the assumption the case was about the assignment of the right to sue for legal malpractice. It is not. It is a simple breach of contract case against the trust. It has nothing to do with an assignment other than proceeds when rights are exercised. The parties contemplated that there were rights that were not assignable. They negotiated a mechanism called an assignment of proceeds. To effectuate their purpose of conveying everything, they agreed to a warranty and remedies to avoid a potential non-performance. The language is crystal clear. The first amended complaint contains sufficient factual allegations to meet the required standard, such as the agreements themselves, including its terms. It also provided facts surrounding the performance by LawFund, the breach with specific facts, and the damages. So all in all, it was sufficient for purposes of a motion to defeat those motions. Buckhalter knowingly undertook to act on behalf of the trust and LawFund. That qualifies it as a fiduciary, as we noted in the briefs. The district court did not go far enough and even get into that issue. And as far as the conversion cause of action, LawFund did not allege a contract with Buckhalter. It's based on conduct. It was specifically pled. The district court did not even consider the factual allegations.
Counsel, if I could just ask you to kind of break your arguments in half for just 1 second, just so I understand where you're going here. You have your claims against Buckhalter, and you have your claims against the trust, correct?
Yes.
And so the claims you're talking about right now are your claims against the law firm, correct?
Against Buckhalter, yes.
Okay.
First argument was dealing with the trust and the breach of contract, which is the first cause of action.
Okay. Just it helps me kind of keep in my mind where you're going here. So I understand the breach of contract argument, and honestly, I think that's your strongest argument you've got today. As to the claims against Buckhalter, I'm just trying to understand, how did Buckhalter owe your client a fiduciary duty? Usually you don't have fiduciary duty to two opposing parties in a sense. So can you kind of walk me through how that would be the case here?
That's exactly the point which was missed by the lower court. The fact of the matter is, when Buckhalter took over the handling of these funds that were belonging to both the trust and law fund, it assumed an obligation. That is the equivalent of a fiduciary duty, as we've set forth in our briefs. And we've laid it out with citations to support the allegations as well. The same thing with regard to the conversion. That applies strictly to Buckhalter as well.
But wasn't Buckhalter acting on behalf of and for the benefit of its client, the trust? Why was he acting on behalf and the benefit of the law fund?
Because when they took over the responsibility to handle the Rosen distributions, part of their obligation was to law fund, knowing that they were entitled to 70% of the proceeds. In fact, what's significant about this case is that Buckhalter paid those dollars for a long period of time until the lawsuit was filed against them, and then they just unilaterally decided
So if I appoint X, I say, look, you will you please distribute on behalf, I owe money to Y. I owe them some money. So I don't want to handle the money for a variety of reasons. I want you to handle it. So would you please pay them money? You pay them the money. And you're saying that creates a fiduciary obligation to the recipient of the funds. And that, it's that simple. So in any situation where X appoints somebody to handle money as part of their job, I hire them to do X, to distribute money, they therefore owe a fiduciary duty to the person who's receiving it.
The key word here is undertook. They would not have been a fiduciary because they had no relationship with LawFund. That was not their client, and they had no relationship. But once they undertook, and we have case authority that we use to support that conclusion, once they undertook the responsibility, and they did, it's clear from the record that they undertook the responsibility because the money went to them, and they wrote the checks to both LawFund and presumably to the trust. And at some point in time, they just stopped paying altogether and kept the money that was remitted by Wong, who was the trustee on the Rosen distribution. So the key word here again, undertook. That changed what is normally considered fiduciary. Because we all, we're all accustomed to hearing fiduciaries, meaning you have a duty to somebody. And that's generally the rule. But it's not the rule here. There's exceptions. This is an exception. When they took over control, managing, the full knowledge of all the responsibilities and everything else, that created the equivalent of fiduciary. Fiduciary is probably the hard word, but the fact of the matter is that's the relationship that was developed. That kind of obligation went directly to the law fund because they had made an agreement to do that. And that's how I would respond to your question. As far as the conversion is concerned, it's basically the same thing. There's no contract between Buckhalter and Law Fund. That's for sure. There's no contract. But once they took over responsibility, it was specifically pled that this became a conversion. It's unrelated. So for the district court to conclude that this dealt with a contract, and therefore was not recoverable, is basically clearly wrong. In fact, we've cited many cases and a lot of authority in our papers, and I would invite the court to take another quick look at it if it has any questions in that regard. So the issue really in this case is control and misconduct, and those were all clearly factual. Pretty much everything here was factual. If you look at the complaint, when I started my discussion, my issue dealt with the simplicity of this pleading. It's just the equivalent of a demur. And pleading itself, which is what you really have to look at, pleading itself lays out all of the requirements for the successful pleading of a cause of action or a claim under these circumstances. And that is why the court was wrong in sustaining or actually in granting the motions to dismiss. It's too early for a motion to dismiss. We're entitled to prove our facts. And those facts were well proved and well documented and well set out in the pleadings itself. That's the real key for this case. I think you're right, Justice. The fact of the matter is it's a strong argument. It's a very strong argument. It's a simple pleading issue. You don't need to go through all the ramifications of anything else. If it set forth the possibility of a cause of action and potential relief using all the assumptions that are provided, then the court had no right at that point to dismiss it without prejudice. And I just want to comment with prejudice, because the fact of the matter is the facts were well enough pled based on the federal rules of civil procedure, but if it was necessary to make it more clear, you know, I don't think it was, then the court should have allowed for the filing of an amendment and amended complaint. And this was the first time that we were seeking an amended complaint on this issue. And standing is clear from the agreements themselves. They were provided in the pleading as attachments, and that's clearly referenced in our papers. So I'd like to respond to any further questions the court may have, and we reserve my remaining time, which appears to be 4 minutes and 45 seconds, according to the clock.
Yes, you may reserve that time for rebuttal.
Thank you. Okay, so I'll turn it over to counsel for the appellees.
We will hear first, as I understand it, from Mr. McCarthy. Is that correct?
That's correct, Your Honor. My name is Dan McCarthy. I'm appearing for Buckhalter. I will be dividing my time with counsel for the other appellees. Ms. Forbath will be speaking for them. Ms. Forbath will go into more detail the issue of standing, which typically is a threshold issue that courts face before they get to more substantive arguments. Here, the bankruptcy court and the district court chose not to focus on the standing issue. And I think, as Ms. Forbath will explain in more detail, the contracts in question, both the proceeds agreement and the claims, I should say the proceeds assignment, under which there was a right to the distributions, and the claims assignment were contracts with LFMG, between the creditor trust and LFMG. LawFund is merely a 51% holder of a membership interest in LFMG, therefore lacks standing. And we think the obvious reason that LawFund filed the lawsuit was because LFMG has not been in good standing for years. I want to talk about the breach of fiduciary duty claim, which is a second claim. LawFund agrees with the general rule that an attorney only owes a duty to the client, and an attorney will not be held liable to a third person not in privity with that attorney. That's the general rule. LawFund also concedes that there's a minor exception to that, which is if the non-client is the intended third-party beneficiary of the legal services being rendered to the client, then the attorney can be held liable to the third party. And LawFund concedes that. Here, that test cannot be met. That's because from the inception, LawFund and LFMG were potentially adverse to the trust because LFMG was a counterparty under the claims assignment and the proceeds assignment, and LawFund was a counterparty under the operating agreement. That potentially adverse relationship ripened into an actually adverse relationship when LFMG, controlled by LawFund, sued Buckhalter. After that point, there was clearly an adverse relationship. At the same time, there was also an adverse relationship with the creditor trust. As LawFund alleges in the First Amended complaint, the trustees did not cooperate in the prosecution of the malpractice claim. So from that point forward, which is when the distribution stopped, there was an adverse relationship. You cannot be an intended beneficiary when there's an adverse relationship. LawFund attempts to sidestep that entire argument in the same way Mr. Dodell just described, which was LawFund's claim is based entirely on Buckhalter's conduct, because LawFund has never argued that it was an intended beneficiary. That's a quote from the reply brief. That distinction is artificial. And that's because Buckhalter, as counsel for the creditor trust, was collecting and distributing monies based upon its attorney-client relationship with the trust. Its conduct was founded on that relationship. You cannot separate that conduct from the attorney-client relationship. The cases cited, interestingly, don't stand for the opposing proposition. Look for the cases cited in the appellant's opening brief and reply brief. There are no cases where there's a conduct-based breach of fiduciary duty claim held by a third party that was not an intended third-party beneficiary. Mr. Dedell argued that it has, he's arguing that it's conduct-based fiduciary duty. They cite the Cleveland versus Johnson case, which has a dicta stating that a party that knowingly undertakes to act on behalf of or for the benefit of another can owe a fiduciary duty. But that case arises in a promoter-investor relationship where there's a fiduciary duty as a matter of law. It cites other cases where there's a fiduciary duty as a matter of law in a joint venture or partnership conduct. The law fund focuses upon the knowingly undertook language in Cleveland versus Johnson, but it ignores the remainder of the sentence, which is to act on behalf of or for the benefit of another. That's where intention comes into effect. Acting on behalf of or for the benefit of another means that the primary purpose must be to benefit the third party. That's the intended beneficiary exception that LawFund tries to avoid. The opening brief also cites City of Hope and Genentech. Those cases don't discuss a third party being an intended beneficiary. If anything, those cases stand for the proposition that mere conduct does not give rise to a fiduciary duty. In City of Hope, there was conduct under an agreement. In Children's Television, there was conduct in selling breakfast cereal. Now, for the first time, there's an argument made in the reply brief that this situation is analogous to an attorney holding money for the benefit of a third party. There's three cases that are cited, Johnstone, Crooks, and PCO Inc. Interestingly, in Johnstone, the attorney specifically agreed to pay $1,000 on a negotiated lien, then gave an NSF check and didn't replace the money. In Crooks, it was similar, where the attorney agreed specifically to act as an escrow holder and then took the money and spent it on his own personal expenses. Here, Buckhalter collected the money for its client. Even the First Amended complaint concedes that Buckhalter was collecting money for the trust, which was a creditor of the Rosen bankruptcy estate. On the conversion claim, the answer is simple. The claim on conversion is rooted in contract. And the NB Inc. versus Smith case that we cite is a clear example of where a contract with a client can't give rise to a claim by a third party against the attorney. LawFund relies upon the Voorhis case. Voorhis is just simply inapplicable. It cites a decision in Fisher, which was that an agent can be sued for conversion. Here, Buckhalter was not an agent of LawFund. That case didn't even mention the economic loss rule. The reply brief cites some other cases, Apple Inc. and another case, Robinson, which also don't support the conclusion that, in fact, they only support the general rule that a conversion claim that's rooted in contract cannot be a good claim. And finally, on the common count claim, it's based upon the other claims, and that's very clear as both the bankruptcy court and the district court held. There's no independent basis for liability on common count. The reply brief argues that common count has been sufficiently alleged, all necessary elements have been alleged. It's still not a separate cause of action. The liability giving rise to the common count claim is liability based upon the other two causes of action. So the common count claim against Buckhalter falls with the other claims. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. We'll hear next from Ms. Forbath.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court, Attorney Tracy Forbath, on behalf of appellees, the trustees of the S&B Surgery Center Creditor Trust. Turning to the breach of contract claim, this claim fails based on the threshold issue of standing. By way of background, LawFund alleges that the trust breached the proceeds agreement by refusing to prosecute a malpractice claim against its own counsel, Buckhalter. LawFund further alleges the trust breached the operating agreement by depriving LawFund of its 70% share of the distribution payments paid to Buckhalter under the Rosen Plan. However, as counsel for Buckhalter has pointed out, the LawFund is not a party nor a third-party beneficiary of the proceeds agreement. This agreement was made between the trust and the corporation. At most, LawFund could claim to be an incidental beneficiary since it's a shareholder of the corporation. However, an incidental beneficiary is insufficient to confer standing for purposes of a breach of contract claim, and LawFund is not entitled to enforce the contract. The authority cited in the appellee's answering brief, Castro and Cal Emergency Physicians, is on point on this issue. Even if LawFund did have standing, however, the malpractice claim was not assigned to the trust and is not assignable under California law. This was properly found by the bankruptcy court and properly affirmed by the district court. The bankruptcy court concluded that a legal malpractice claim is not a claim that arised out of the Fortress loan transaction. It also concluded that nothing in the agreement supported LawFund's contention that a malpractice claim against the trust legal counsel arises out of a post-confirmation action in the debtor's bankruptcy case. Even though LawFund attempts to argue the claim is broadly defined to include all claims and rights of indemnity, and this creates an inference that the legal malpractice action is included within the proceeds agreement and the claims assignment, that is simply not the case here, and that definition cannot be stretched to include legal malpractice claim. Additionally, this point has not been addressed yet by counsels, the doctrine of collateral estoppel would prevent LawFund from attempting to re-argue this issue. This issue has been fully litigated in the bankruptcy court's dismissal of the malpractice claim and became final after it was affirmed by this court. And collateral estoppel applies here to prevent the First Amended complaint in this action. LawFund also has not and cannot plead that the trust had control over Buchalter's distribution. The trust did not participate in depriving LawFund of any amounts allegedly owed under the proceeds agreement. There is no allegation that the trust had any contractual duty to order Buchalter to pay the funds, nor can there be an allegation along these lines, as that was simply not the case.
Well, hold on, counsel. Let me just jump in here. I think this is the one part of the case for you I have the most concern about, is that, as I understand this case, what they've alleged is that there was a deal, that the proceeds would be split between these two entities, and that the law fund here is arguing that they weren't being paid their share. And maybe it was Buchalter's, again, this is all just hypothetically here. I'm not saying any of this is true, but the allegations are that maybe Buchalter was withheld the payments because they were mad that they were being sued for malpractice. But at the end of the day, they were acting on behalf of your client. And therefore, your client is the one who actually owes the money to law fund. If I'm understanding the allegations correct, at this stage, why isn't that just a very simple breach of contract case? There was a contract to pay the funds and the funds weren't being paid.
Well, Your Honor, on this record, the trust did not have control over Buchalter's distribution.
But this is a motion to dismiss, correct?
It's not about the record, it's about the pleadings.
And Your Honor, the pleadings include the terms of the two agreements at issue here. And under those terms of the agreements, there was no ability for the trust to receive the funds, and the trust was not in possession of those funds. So the trust was unable to render payment of the funds to law fund.
I understand that might be where you think the evidence is going to go. But as Judge Graber just said, this is a motion to dismiss. We take the pleadings, and the pleadings say the trust was obligated to pay the money and the trust didn't pay it. So isn't that a breach of contract case, and aren't we go to summary judgment? And maybe summary judgment, everything you said might be absolutely true and this case gets thrown out. But at this stage of the proceedings, why would we get into whether the trust had control of the money or not? That's a factual inquiry, isn't it?
Well, Your Honor, normally that would be a factual inquiry, but here those facts have been included in the allegations of the complaint and they are presently before the court.
Well, how are they? How are they presently before the court? I mean, where are these factual allegations that they didn't control the fund?
Your Honor, they are part of the terms of the two agreements.
So you're saying we would incorporate the two agreements and then read the two agreements and then decide as a factual matter that they didn't have control of the funds?
Yes, Your Honor. The agreements have been incorporated by reference as part of
But your interpretation is in dispute, is it not? I mean, you have the document. You say, this is what it means. This is what it means. Oh, maybe it does mean that. Maybe right. Means it. But in a motion to dismiss, you want us to interpret the document as to give your meaning of the agreement? Isn't that a factual dispute? I think you said yes. I thought you said yes, it is a factual dispute.
Your Honor, we would assert that is not a factual dispute here, as it, pardon me, is based upon the terms of the agreements, which are included in the complaint.
Thank you, counsel. You're about 15 seconds from the end. If you have one more sentence to conclude.
Then I will just conclude by asserting that leave to amend should not be granted in this instance for all the reasons asserted today at argument and in the party's briefs. Thank you so much.
Thank you, counsel. And Mr. Dodell, you have some rebuttal time remaining.
Yes, thank you. It's obvious that if you look at the agreements, the three agreements, the parties intended for LawFund to be the controlling party in whatever was to take place. The agreements are attached as part of the pleadings. As far as the assignment of legal malpractice, that's not the issue here. The parties obviously understood that certain claims were not assigned. And so they dealt with that by creating a mechanism to allow LawFund as part of the entity to basically control the outcome.
Well, let me ask you this on the issue of on the second issue, the issue about whether it's a breach of contract claim. I mean, that seems to be what some of us are interested in discussing. The question in my mind is that your opposing counsel said, look, you look at the agreements, it's clear what the meaning is. And it's this, it's X. What's your response to that?
The response to that is that it's a disputed issue. This is a pleading issue. And as far as the pleading is concerned, if you look at it at face value, taking all the assumptions that go along with it, the fact of the matter is it's adequately pled.
But counsel, what is your specific response to the assertion that the agreements make clear that the trust was without any ability to ensure the payment of the 70% that you are alleging was owed?
Well, the reality is that Buckhalter was acting as the agent of the trust, certainly throughout the entire matter. And by taking that responsibility, it really does go to the trust's liability as well. It's the acts and conduct of its own agent that did that. And so it seems to me that if we focus on the only real issue, and that's why I started my argument today with the comment that this is really a very simple breach of contract. And if the pleading itself, given all its assumptions, is sufficient to meet the requirements of knowledge and is clear enough, then the bottom line really is this is the wrong time for a motion. I think the court is correct. They're really right, if they really are, then the appropriate time would be for purposes of a summary judgment motion or some other motion. Not now. It's just too soon. And if you just take the document as it speaks, and we certainly have dealt with that in our papers, if you just look at the document itself and nothing more, it's clear that it met all of the standard requirements that from the federal civil rules. And so therefore, you don't have to go much further than that as to anything. The motion should have been denied. It should have been allowed to be litigated. It should have been an allowance for discovery, and otherwise, just every person that doesn't like what it says there can have a case dismissed. Doesn't make any sense, and it doesn't totally unsupported by any of the authorities. We have spent a lot of time and effort, of course, we did that, putting forth all of our positions and citing authorities for all of it. And I think that that's persuasive, and the party should be allowed to litigate this matter to a conclusion following all the rules. And with that, I submit.
Thank you, counsel. The case just argued is submitted, and we appreciate very much the arguments from all three of you.